So this is what I woke up to today. Snow here, just outside of Toronto, Canada. And I decided to go for a little bit of a deeper dive today in my story. And I'm going to sit down with you and have a longer coffee chat and talk about my year actually, because it was a very challenging year. And when you're on social media apps or fitness apps, you get what they call a year in review, and it shows you how many steps you walked, how many stairs you climbed, how many levels you climbed, how many achievements, how many rewards. My year was a little bit different than that. It is quite an intense story, and it is my testimony. It is a story of how God brought me from death to life, from death's door of people speaking death over me and being in the hospital, and then walking out of the hospital 2 weeks from that time period. As a precursor, I just want to give a trigger warning. I may show some graphic images throughout this journey of me being in the hospital, images of blood, things like that. So if that is going to affect you, you may want to not watch this video. I had been diagnosed with stage 4 metastatic cancer January 28th, 2019. They told me that the cancer had come back in the bones. My initial primary diagnosis was breast cancer. It's still breast cancer, but it has moved to a new location. It has moved to the bones. Doctors at that point said that cancer is throughout your entire body. That's microscopically, you have cancer cells throughout your entire body. That's why it's called metastatic or stage 4. At that time, I was blessed enough that someone from my church had told me about this healing ministry called Face-to-Face Encounters Healing Ministry in Stouffville, run by Tim and Dorothy Rice. This year, 2021, I had a scan. Around April, I got the results of the scan. It was a phone call with my oncologist. The first thing she said is, "Are you having trouble breathing?" And I said, "No, I have had no symptoms whatsoever." I really, honestly, for the entire metastatic cancer diagnosis and prognosis, I had had zero symptoms, zero symptoms. I was going to the gym. I was taking Karis Bible College. I was doing all these things and I felt great. I felt fantastic. Then she said, "But if you do notice that your breathing is having problems, there could be fluid building up in the pleural space and you would have to come in and have a big needle put in and have the fluid drained." And as soon as she said that, I immediately thought, no, I don't think so. I am gonna continue my life. On the Monday, found the store. They had two bikes in my size. I said, I need a size 52 women road bike. And I said, okay, God, if the bike is still there on Thursday, that's my bike. So I started bike riding. I was so excited. I got the gear, I got the gloves and helmet and everything I needed, and I started riding 10 kilometers a day, 20. I built my way up, 50 kilometers one way, 50 kilometers, 100 kilometers round trip, and I started working my way up to longer rides, and I was still feeling great. And I knew that as my fitness grew, I would be able to do longer rides. There was fluid building up in the pleural spaces, but I didn't really realize it. I had started to feel shortness of breath, and I had started to have a bit of a cough. And on July 27th, I said, I think I have to go to the emergency department. But before that, what I did is I called my boss, the director of Andrew Womack Ministries Canada. He did a prayer session over me. I just felt so supported. I stood on the word, I stood on the promises of God, and he spoke scriptures over me like a personal sermon for an hour and a half. And I just felt like, no, I'm good. I just need to rebuke the symptoms, stand on the word, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. And I just said, no, I refuse this disease. I refuse any symptoms. And I said, I'm going to continue on. This is gone. The fluid in the pleural space is gone. I refuse to accept these symptoms. Around the time when people could travel from the States into Canada, my brother and his entire family decided to rent a cottage and come and visit me. And we stayed at this cottage and I was gonna go swimming and biking. Well, the very first hill I was riding up with my nephew, and as soon as I hit the hill, my lungs weren't working. I'm trying to ride my bike and my lungs are not going along. I just had to get off my bike and walk up the hill. And there was a lake and I absolutely love swimming. So I went in the water, and as soon as I was immersed in the water up to my neck, I said, I don't trust my lungs. And that's the first time this has ever happened. Even with a life jacket, I think this is dangerous for me to swim because I had shortness of breath. And at that time, what was happening was as soon as I would go up in elevation, go up a hill or go up even a flight of stairs, I would have to go up two steps and then rest and recover for a couple minutes and go up two steps and rest. And then at the top of the stairs, I put chairs at the top of every set of stairs and I would have to sit on the chair and recover. Kind of knew that something is wrong, but I was still pressing on with the word because that is what I had been taught at Kara's Bible College. Stand on the promises, rebuke your symptoms, speak to your mountain. All of the things I had learned, I was putting into practice, and I didn't know that I had been taking a year of theory, which is getting deep in the word of theology of the Bible, in order to prepare me for this practical exam. This was putting the word into practice, and I didn't really expect it. It kind of came, like I said, it was a slow build. There was fluid building, and I was slowly getting out of breath. These symptoms were building. There was a concern, but because I had spent a year in the Word, in the Bible, studying Scripture, I was so committed and so dedicated to the Word that I really thought that this would just go away. I just thought I could speak the Word, speak to my mountain, and it would go. Now we're coming up to closer to the time of when I really noticed that things are ramping up. At that time, I had a lot of pain in the back and just kind of everywhere on the right side. I would have cold packs, then I would have hot packs. This is some pain. Maybe I'm getting pain from bike riding. I didn't think that it would need medical intervention. At that point, I started to not be able to sleep too well. Well, I couldn't sleep on my right side. I always had to sleep on my left side. When I slept on my right side, I would feel these liquidy noises or a wheezing noise. It reached a point where I was having trouble eating now. Whenever I ate, I felt very uncomfortable. And then one day, I could not drink water. And later on, they told me that the pressure, the fluid in the pleural space had pushed my trachea so far that when I tried to drink, it wasn't going straight down the trachea. It was being pushed over. And then it finally reached this epic level where I couldn't even drink water. And I said, oh my goodness, I'm going to get dehydrated. I better go to the hospital. In the evening, I go to the hospital, Tuesday, August 31st, 2021. It's a totally packed emergency room, and I finally do get to the emergency physician, and he puts the stethoscope on the back to hear my lungs. He's listening to my lungs, and he puts the stethoscope on the right side, and he keeps going back from the left side to the right side, left side. And he goes, I don't hear anything. I don't hear anything on your right side. And suddenly at that moment, I jumped about 50 people in line, and I'm in a room by myself, and they said, your right lung has collapsed. You have no air in your lung, in your right side. And later on, they told me that if the pleural fluid had continued to build, it would have gone to the left side, it would have collapsed the left side, and I would have died. And the emergency doctor said that normally what they would do is, with the amount of fluid that I had, is that they would try to do what they call a tap, where they try to go in with an ultrasound, find out where the fluid is, so they're able to, with the ultrasound, see where the fluid is, go in with the needle, and take out the fluid. And it was extremely painful. They had to give me painkillers, and so I had to lay over a bed, and the emergency doctor was behind me, and he had the ultrasound, and he did the tapping with the needle and pulled out the fluid, and he pulled out about 1.2 liters of fluid. And I was literally shocked at this time. I'm gonna show you a picture here. He held up 1.2 liter in this bag. This came out of you. And I was literally shocked. 1.2 liters had come out of what I thought was my lung. Later on, I learned it was the pleural space, the space between your lung. But at this point, it was in the cavity of the lung. In other words, the pleural space had taken over the cavity of where the lung is, and the lung had collapsed to zero. They were in the pleural space cavity, and they take out this amount of fluid, and they're waving it at me going, do you realize how severe this is? How critical you left this to have that much fluid come out? And they said, that is just the tip of the iceberg. You still have so much fluid, and your lung is still collapsed, so you're still in critical condition here. That was quite a shocker. I was already feeling a million times better just from having 1.2 liters taken out of me. While I was in shock, I couldn't believe it. I didn't know what was gonna happen. I thought they're gonna put me on a ventilator. There was so much going on at that time. I had so many people praying for me. I had my people at work, Andrew Womack Ministries Canada. I had Tim and Dorothy from Face to Face Encounters, a ministry in Stouffville. I had my friend Lynn, and I had a bunch of people who are really strong believers praying on the word, standing with me, and I was texting them. And Michelle from the Olive Branch Church, and people just texting me saying, you're gonna make it, you're gonna make it. And still in the middle of all this chaos, I'm still standing positive on the word. I'm still believing that everything is gonna be fine. But it was such a huge test on me, because anything physical, it's a huge test on your faith. So I spent a few days recovering from that procedure. And then on Friday, September 3rd, they came into my room, did the same thing again. I exposed my back, and then they use the ultrasound. They get another 900 milliliters, where basically at about 2 liters have come out of me. And I'm already feeling so much better. I don't have the shortness of breath. I don't have the coughing as much, but I'm still in critical condition. My lung is still collapsed. Then they tell me that they're gonna do this procedure where they're gonna put a tube in the back or the side, depending on how you look at it, through my ribs into the space where my lung is. And this tube is gonna go down to the bottom of the lung. So every day they don't have to do this needle tapping. They can do just the fluid release through this tube. And at this point, I kind of knew, but I didn't really know, because I tried not to Google it too much, but it's a process called pleural effusion, where you get a buildup of fluid. And they said, you're gonna have to have this tube, and it's gonna be in you for the rest of your life, because this fluid is gonna go on continually. They said, we're scheduling you this procedure on Tuesday, September 7th, and you're gonna have this tube sticking out of you. And that's what it is, and I'll put a picture here of what it looked like. It's also called a catheter. To me, it was just a tube in the ribs. I went to a department where they had ultrasound technicians, radiology technicians, where they could see where the fluid is, get the precise location, put in the tube. It was so painful. It was just over the top painful. Put the tube through my ribs into the space of my lungs. And during the procedure, they took out another 1.5 liter. So now we're up to about 3.5 liters that's come out of me, which is still so shocking. It's just, I cannot believe I had this much fluid and I was still managing to bike. That is a testimony to God. And actually, I forgot to tell you, on the first night that I came into the hospital, I'll put a picture here. They said that on one lung, I was still operating at 99% oxygen, which is physically impossible. That is supernaturally God. That is physically impossible. I was operating one lung on 99% oxygen, and I took a picture of me with my mask, and then I took a picture of the machine, and I'll link it here. But that is a testimony to God. So I'm still, the whole time, I'm still believing God, and God can work through the medical system, through medical intervention, and God can work through the doctors. God's hands can be the doctor's hands. God can work through hospitals to get you well. I went home. I went home for a day. They said, you can go home now. The tube is inserted in you. You can go home. And they're gonna come to your house and remove fluid every day. I went home for a day and I could not even stand the tube. It was unbearable. I couldn't even sit back like this. Whenever I just sat, I couldn't sit back because the tube was sticking out of me. I went back to Emerge. Catherine, the director of Caris Bible College Toronto, got me back. Put me back into the hospital after I'd been home for a day. I tried it for a day, I couldn't do it. On that day, Tim and Dorothy came and they said, you need to not waver, stand on the word, and absolutely declare that you are getting out of the hospital, that the fluid will be either dried up through the procedures or supernaturally dried up through God, and that the doctors will let you walk out of the hospital. And at this point, I didn't know how much fluid is going to be produced, if this is going to be ongoing forever, how this is going to work. But they said, you need to absolutely stand on the word, declare it to be true, declare the promises, and say, you will get out of this hospital. And at this point, I thought, this might take a week, months, it might take till Christmas. It might take a whole year, I don't know, but I am going to stand on this, that I am getting out of this hospital. This was on the Wednesday, September 8th, and they said you have to pick a timeline. And even if it doesn't happen by that timeline, you need to stand on that timeline. And I said, well, I don't know the timeline. God knows the timeline. So they said, well, why don't we say Friday? And even if it doesn't happen by Friday, that's okay, because you have stood on the word and not wavered, and you are deciding that you're going to get out by Friday. And no matter what it looks like in the natural, you decide that you are waiting on that for Friday. So I said, well, that's only 2 days. Does that give God enough time to work? Some of the ridiculous thoughts I'm thinking. Of course God can work that fast. Then on the Thursday, they once again came into my room. The nurses came into my room with the tube now there, so they don't have to do the tapping. And they took out 850 milliliters. Every day they would take out fluid and then they would do an x-ray. So this is the new routine now. It was getting so painful to take out the fluid. And every night that I had that tube in, every night I had to get major painkillers. I had to ask for the highest dose of oxycodone, I believe it was. On Friday, September 10th, I had another 1 liter taken out. This is now the Friday that I had stood on the word. At that point, Catherine Smith, who's the director of Caris Bible College Toronto, said to me, I have a word for you. I'm coming personally to your hospital room to tell you this word. And she came and she said, you know the story in Luke when Jesus is in the boat with the disciples and the water is gushing over the side of the boat and Jesus is sleeping peacefully on a pillow, still getting totally drenched, and the disciples come and say, Master, Master, can't you see that we're drowning? And he woke up and he rebuked the wind and he rebuked the waves. And the storm stopped and they were carried to the other side. Catherine said, that is the word I have for you, that you will be carried to the other side and all of the fluid, just like the Red Sea. And funny enough, the fluid was red because it has blood in it. And I'll show you a picture here, that the Red Sea will part and you will walk out on dry land and the storm will be completely stopped. So this was Friday, September 10th. I had another liter of fluid. In the natural world, it looked like nothing had changed. This is gonna be an ongoing thing. Every day, take out fluid. Every day, have an x-ray. And then they actually did say, okay, now space in your lung is only 2/3 full of fluid. And then now it's only half full of fluid. There was progress on the x-rays. That was encouraging. And on Saturday, September 11th, I had another 650 milliliter taken out. We were now past the Friday, past the day when I had stood on the word, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter the day. God knows the time. So I just continue to say, I will get out of the hospital. The fluid will be either naturally or supernaturally dried up. And the doctors will agree that I can walk out of the hospital. Sunday, September 12th, and it turned out to be the very last time they took out fluid, but I didn't know it that day. They took out 300 milliliter and it was so excruciating. I had to have them give me painkillers right before they did the procedure, and that 300 milliliter was like squeezing right out of me. And then on that day, they told me Monday, September 13th, they're taking out the tube. And then the next day, Tuesday, September 14th, I went home. And if you add up all the fluid levels that I had taken out in that 2-week period, it came out to 6.4 liters of fluid. And that was in the pleural spaces. And they said, your lung is going to expand naturally. They took the tube out. They said, your lung will expand naturally and you can go home. And this is, honest to God, a pure miracle at this point. Because if you've ever heard of anyone that has had pleural effusion, this is huge. This is unheard of. It is really a pure miracle from God. And since that time, since September 14th, we're now into December, I have had no fluid buildup. So it's 90 days later, 3 months later, God has supernaturally dried up any fluid, if there was gonna be any. There has been no fluid, I've had no symptoms. It is a pure miracle. And that is my testimony. I really do hope that it serves someone out there. Thank you for watching all the way to the end. My prayer is that if this video just touches one other person, then it will be worth it. If this helps just one other person in their journey, I will be forever grateful. Thank you for listening. It was supernaturally guided by God, and God was with me every step of the way, and all the words spoken over me about standing on the word, do not waver, do not be afraid, only believe. You will get to the other side. Jesus will supernaturally transpose you to the other side. The Red Sea will part. The fluid will go and I will walk out on dry land. All of these things that were spoken over me came true. And that is the miracle. And that is my Christmas miracle story for today. How God used me to show his goodness. And I was a vessel, a physical vessel on this earth to show how someone can be taken from death to life.
And I can't help but smile. Do you know how much I love you? And we just sing along. Can't help but feeling just loving this moment. Can we stay here forever? I'm loving this moment. Can we stay here together? If I could stop the time, don't you know?